Cantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Lyme, the First Epidemic of Climate Change by Mary Beth Pfeiffer, narrated by Randye, Kaye. Introduction. On the day after Christmas in 2015, I took a walk with my 30-year-old son in an old cornfield that long ago morphed with changing patterns of agriculture into a gently tended meadow we know well. This 9-acre patch of earth across the dead-end lane from our home in upstate New York has a rare and wonderful feature that we have worked with the cooperation of neighbors to sustain, a mowed trail around its perimeter that allows access even when summer mustard, milkweed, and goldenrod are 4 feet high and the blackberry brambles profuse. As we often do, we took with us that day a coterie of mismatched family dogs, a Shih Tzu, Chihuahua, Springer Spaniel, and a beige rescue that we call a boxer. The day was unusually balmy in the last week of a year that had gone down as the warmest in 135 years of weather history, followed only, but considerably, by the year before. The temperature had topped out at 55 degrees Fahrenheit that December 26th. It had reached into the mid-60s on Christmas and hit 72 in nearby Poughkeepsie the day before. For that time of year, daytime temperatures at or near freezing would have been far more typical here in the Hudson Valley, 100 miles north of New York City. Instead, it had been so warm that forsythia buds had sprouted in one neighbor's garden, crocuses peeked through in another's. When we came back from our short walk, we did what has become in New York State a routine practice from spring through fall, but not for winter. We checked the dogs for ticks. When we were done, we had picked 21 black-legged ticks from the scruffs of our pups, each about the size of a small freckle, and all with one goal in mind, to latch onto a warm body and suck its blood. When I moved to this rural county in upstate New York 30 years ago, such things did not happen. Ticks certainly did not show up in December, were indeed rare, and if seen, were usually of the easier-to-spot dog tick variety, which infrequently carried Rocky Mountain spotted fever. They did not pack the potential arsenal of infection of the small, ubiquitous, black-legged ticks of today. Every year, the list of diseases found within this tick grows longer, including new bacterial, viral, and parasitic pathogens. These infections have changed daily life in the county in which I live, and they have altered the course of many lives, particularly when they go unrecognized for weeks or months. Mention Lyme disease at a gathering here, and nearly everyone has a story. The odd rash, fever, occasional palsy, meningitis, and joint pain of early stages. The sometimes crippling arthritis, memory loss, depression, numbness, and fatigue of advanced disease. Even the rare infection that can kill. In towns near me, Lyme carditis, in which the bacterium quickly cripples the heart, claimed a 17-year-old high school boy and a 38-year-old father of three within 5 months. A woman who at 91 was an active gardener died after being bitten by a tick and contracting another common tick-borne disease, babesiosis. Black-legged ticks have taken up residence in half of continental America's counties, spreading west, north, and south from the Connecticut town for which Lyme disease was named in the late 1970s, like some unchecked algal bloom. These 8-legged arachnids have turned childhood from a time to explore nature to a time to fear it. My 7-year-old grandson has been warned since he could walk, don't brush up against the tall grasses at the edge of the trail, don't venture into the weeds, tuck socks into pants, sit still for repellent, check yourself and remind mommy to also. Then pray we see the tick and pity the parent who doesn't know to look. Guidance counselors and teachers have told me of children, the most frequently infected, missing months, sometimes years of school, because the tick went unseen or the symptoms were misconstrued. But happenstance is not the only reason that cases are missed or treatment delayed, I have learned. Many patients have suffered needlessly in the United States, Canada, England, France, Germany, and many other countries because of how Lyme disease has been framed in American medical journals and treatment guidelines. This is an illness that has been minimized, underestimated, and politicized to the point that doctors fear treating it aggressively with a cheap, common drug, antibiotics. I began to write about Lyme disease as an investigative reporter for a Dutchess County, New York newspaper in 2012. I intended to write one or two stories about a prevalent local disease, focusing on its origins, growth, and management by health officials. But Lyme disease proved to be a story far beyond the parameters I'd envisioned. Over a period of 4 years, I studied the policies, paper trail, and scientific literature. I tested the postulates of patients and their advocates. Many of their assertions, I concluded, were true. Decades-old testing protocols failed to diagnose many people with the disease. The risk of over-testing and falsely diagnosing people with Lyme disease was exaggerated at the expense of cases missed and symptoms dismissed. Official figures did not reflect the epidemic scope and were soon revised tenfold. Human trials concluded that short-term antibiotics eradicated the bug, while animal and test tube studies showed they didn't. And then there was the politics of Lyme disease. Doctors who prescribed repeated courses of antibiotics, standard in other diseases, faced professional disciplinary charges, huge legal fees, and sometimes suspension or loss of their licenses. Research was discredited, ignored, or relegated to second-tier journals when it challenged prevailing dogma. Scientists who were invested in a benign view of Lyme disease used access to elite journals to uphold the status quo, and little money was available for treatment trials because the medical system purported to have the answers to Lyme disease care. And yet, some 10 to 20% of people infected annually with Lyme disease, estimated at 380,000 Americans in 2015, have symptoms that linger months and sometimes years after treatment. The United States Centers for Disease Control and Prevention, CDC, calls the condition post-treatment Lyme disease syndrome, and it affects multitudes of people as disease-toting ticks move around the world. Lyme disease is rife in most every country in Western Europe. It is in Russia, China, former Soviet satellite states, and, though officially unrecognized, in Australia too. In one small study, half the ticks in two parks in New York City harbored the Lyme disease pathogen. In a Chicago park, Ixodes ticks, some laden with the Lyme pathogen, outnumbered every other tick carried by migrating birds in 2010. 5 years earlier, there were none. In a northwestern suburb of Beijing, 1 in 20 residents tested positive in a Chinese study that said, quite remarkably, underdiagnosis of early Lyme disease and physical damage at advanced stage are a huge problem in this area. But infected ticks haven't just moved around. They have added layers of woe. 45% of ticks in the French Ardennes, for example, carry more than one disease. Some have five. A tick-borne malaria-like illness, babesiosis, unheard of not so long ago, became a nationally reportable disease in 2011 after cases skyrocketed in some American states, and it slipped into the U.S. blood supply, infecting premature babies and killing at least 8 people. Another rapidly emerging pathogen, Borrelia miyamotoi, prevalent in the San Francisco Bay Area, has upped the ante on Lyme. Tick babies, hatching by the thousands, can inherit the bug directly from mom rather than get it with its first animal blood meal. Add to this Powassan virus, which is also passed to baby ticks, transmitted within 15 minutes of a bite and is fatal 10% of the time, and anaplasmosis, a bacterial infection that is particularly dangerous for the elderly. Now consider how a tick is infected with two or three of these organisms, for which a doctor may not know to look, and for which testing is not routine, can wreak havoc in a human body. This spreading toll of tick-borne disease is not a random act of nature. By virtue of the developed world's lifestyle and influence, the cars, the suburban tracks and carved-up forests, the diminished biodiversity, the emissions and airplanes, we have paved the way for the first global epidemic abetted by climate change. Warming may not have caused this scourge, but it most certainly is enabling it. The pathogen that causes Lyme disease, Borrelia burgdorferi, has existed in the environment for millennia, just as black-legged ticks have long been transported on the wings of birds to new and far-flung climes. What is different is that they now survive there. We have revived and empowered a sleeping giant, the Borrelia bug, by helping to create conditions favorable to the ticks that deliver it. Climate change alone hasn't done this. Ticks thrive amid the mice and deer so prevalent in an attenuated post-industrial era, but its influence in supporting ticks, the vector of human transmission, is key. Ticks have climbed latitudes like ladders. They have moved up mountains. Driven by warmer winters and earlier springs, they are predicted to move well north into Canada in coming years, just as they migrated up the Atlantic seaboard and north into Scandinavia at the close of the 20th century. Lyme disease, of course, is not the only epidemic to blossom in our changing world. Illnesses carried by mosquitoes, Zika, West Nile, chikungunya, dengue fever, malaria, are proliferating and are predicted to worsen as the globe warms. The diseases they carry today annually cause millions of illnesses in tropical countries, and in the case of malaria, nearly a 500,000 deaths. When these illnesses arrive on U.S. shores, they capture the public imagination and lead the nightly news in a way that Lyme disease never has. Yet the Lyme toll in the United States and many developed countries is far higher, perhaps 4 or 5 million Americans infected to date, than West Nile, Zika, and all other mosquito-borne illnesses combined. And, like West Nile, Lyme sometimes kills, although the numbers are largely unknown. Late-stage Lyme disease has even led to suicide, an outgrowth both of the illness and society's regard for it. For official purposes, Lyme disease is not called an epidemic. It is an endemic, a term with far less urgency, reserved for an illness that comes to stay. It emerges, it takes root, and it does not leave. It is a slow burn, this scourge, established, entrenched, and for many, inescapable. But its second-class status also stems from how Lyme disease has been managed and shaped. Treatment guidelines issued by the Infectious Diseases Society of America, IDSA, in 2006 diminish the lingering symptoms of Lyme disease sufferers, calling them the aches and pains of daily living. This, while studies from Columbia University, Johns Hopkins, and elsewhere have measured significant neurological, cognitive, and physical impairments in treated patients. One study equated the quality of life of those with long-standing Lyme disease to people with congestive heart failure. Others have linked the disease to mental illness and showed brains deprived of blood flow. Borrelia burgdorferi is a clever, adaptable bug. It has a hugely complex genetic profile, with more independently replicating structures called plasmids than any other bacterium. It doesn't need iron, unlike most other bacteria, removing one option for our immune systems to starve it into submission. It grows slowly, confounding drugs that work on rapidly dividing cells. It hides in places that diagnostic tests do not reach. This tiny, spiral-shaped organism is actually a boon to ticks. Those infected are more likely to find a blood meal and, ominously, may even cope better in drier, hotter conditions than most that do not carry the Lyme pathogen. In 2014, a report by the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, a multinational effort, said the period from 1983 to 2012 was likely the warmest 30 years in the Northern Hemisphere of the previous 1,400 years. The report, relying on multiple independent temperature and climate indicators around the globe, called this robust multi-decadal warming. Tellingly, the U.S. government monitors Lyme disease as a key indicator of the effect and pace of climate change. Like millions of other people, I see this change in my everyday life. It means that on a short walk in late December, I found 21 ticks on four panting, happy dogs that like nothing better than a romp through our shared preserve. When I look at that lovely field, I see something else. I see a beautiful, inviting menace, a dark and dangerous wood. I see the first epidemic in the era of climate change, long in the making, global and here to stay. Call it, if you will, the first pandemic. There are things we can do to protect ourselves, to control the bug, to limit its spread. You will hear about that in this book, but you will hear also about the missed opportunities, the misconceptions, and the human contribution to an epidemic that, for now at least, is beyond our ability to stop. Chapter 1. Ticks. Rising. Evolution has endowed the big-footed snowshoe hare with a particularly nifty skill. Over a period of about 10 weeks, as autumn days shorten in the high peaks and boreal forests, the nimble, nocturnal hare transforms itself. Where it was once a tawny brown to match the pine needles and twigs amid which it forages, the hare turns silvery white, just in time for the falling of winter snow. This transformation is no inconsequential feat. Lepus americanus, as it is formally known, is able to jump 10 feet and run at a speed of 27 miles per hour, propelled by powerful hind legs and a fierce instinct to live. But it nonetheless ends up, 86% of the time by one study, as a meal for a lynx, red fox, coyote, or even a goshawk or great horned owl. The change of coat is a way to remain invisible, to hide in the brush or fly over the snow unseen, long enough at least to keep the species going. Snowshoe hares are widely spread throughout the colder, higher reaches of North America, in the wilderness of western Montana, on the coniferous slopes of Alaska, and in the forbidding reaches of the Canadian Yukon. The Yukon is part of the Beringia, an ancient swath of territory that linked Siberia and North America by a land bridge that, with the passing of the last ice age 11,000 years ago, gave way to the Bering Strait. All manner of mammals, plants, and insects ferried east and west across that bridge, creating over thousands of years the rich boreal forest. But in this place, north of the 60th parallel, the axiom of life colored by stinging cold, early snow, and concrete ribbons of ice has been upended in the cosmic blink of an eye. The average temperature has increased by 2 degrees Celsius in the last half century and by 4 degrees in the winter. Glaciers are rapidly receding, releasing ancient torrents of water into Kluane Lake, a 150-square-mile reflecting pool that has been called a crown jewel of the Yukon. Lightning storms, ice jams, forest fires, rain, these things are suddenly more common. Permafrost is disappearing. Such rapid-fire changes across a broad swath of northern latitudes are testing the adaptive abilities of the snowshoe hare, however swift and nimble it may be. Snow arrives later, snow melts earlier, but the hare changes its coat according to a long set schedule, which is to say the snowshoe is sometimes snowy white when its element is still robustly brown. And that makes it an easier target for prey. In 2016, wildlife biologists who tracked the hares in a rugged wilderness in Montana gave this phenomenon a name, climate change-induced camouflage mismatch. The hares molted as they always had. It's just that the snow didn't come. Survival rates dropped by 7% as predation increased. In order to outwit its newest enemy, warmer winters, snowshoe hares would need something on the order of a natural miracle, what the biologists, writing in the journal Ecology Letters, called an evolutionary rescue. Like the Yukon, this pristine corner of Montana was projected to lose yet more snow cover. There would be perhaps an additional month of bare forest floor by the middle of this century, on which snowshoe hares would stand out like bright white balloons. In the tally of species that will evolve or perish as temperatures rise, consider now the moose. The lumbering king of the deer family, known for antlers that can span 6 feet like giant outstretched fingers, faces a litany of survival threats, from wolves and bears to brain worms and liver fluke parasites. But in the late 1990s, in many northern states and Canada, something else began to claim adult cows and bull moose and, in even greater numbers, their single or twin calves. Lee Kantar is the moose biologist for the state of Maine, which means he makes a living climbing the rugged terrain of north-central Maine when a GPS collar indicates a moose has died. A lean man with a prominent salt-and-pepper mustache who wears flannel shirts and jeans to work, Kantar tagged 60 moose in January of 2014 around Moosehead Lake in the Maine Highlands. By the end of that year, 12 adults and 22 calves were dead, 57% of the group. When biologists examined the carcasses, they found what they thought was the cause. Calves, not even a year old, harbored up to 60,000 blood-sucking arthropods known as winter ticks. In Vermont, dead moose were turning up with 100,000 ticks each. In New Hampshire, the moose population had dropped from 7,500 to 4,500 from the 1990s to 2014. The emaciated bodies of cows, bulls, and calves bearing similar infestations of ticks. These magnificent animals were literally being bled to death. Winter ticks have been known to afflict moose since the late 1800s. In a normal year, a single moose might carry 1,000 or even 20,000 ticks. In a particularly harsh winter, when moose are underfed and weak, anemia and hypothermia wrought by ticks can make the difference between life and death. Bill Samuel, a retired University of Alberta biology professor, has spent a career studying the moose of North America. He painstakingly counted 149,916 ticks on a moose in Alberta in 1988. In a 2004 book, he recounts episodes of ticks killing moose in Saskatchewan in the spring of 1916, in Nova Scotia and New Brunswick in the 1930s, and in Elk Island National Park in central Alberta at points from the 1940s through the 1990s. Some of the animals were so infested that there was not a tick-free spot in the arachnids' favored places, the anus, the inguinal area, the sternum, the withers, and lower shoulders. In futile attempts to rid the parasite, these pathetic animals had rubbed against trees to seek relief, losing long, lustrous fur and leaving grayish, mottled patches. They are called ghost moose. Moose have long died from disease, predators, hunting, and sometimes ticks, but their losses in the early 21st century had a different, more threatening, more consequential implication. In 2015, two environmental organizations, alarmed at population trends, petitioned the U.S. Secretary of the Interior to have the Midwestern moose listed as an endangered species. In Minnesota, the number of moose dropped 58% in the decade through 2015, similar to losses in New England. Environmentalists believe moose could well be eradicated in the Midwest by 2020, with stocks declining precipitously in Wisconsin, Minnesota, and Michigan. Lee Cantar knew that ticks were killing his moose in Maine. What's becoming clear is why winter ticks had infested his herd, draining half their blood from every available patch of skin. The greatest threat confronting the species, declared the Center for Biological Diversity and Honor the Earth in the 2015 petition to help moose, is climate change. Not hunters, not habitat loss, not even pollution, though that is important. Moose like and need the cold. They become sluggish when it's warm, failing to forage as they should and becoming weak and vulnerable. In the warmer, shorter winters of the U.S. Midwest and Northeast, bumper crops of winter ticks are surviving to wake up when the trees burst to life in earlier springs. They have more time in longer falls to cling in veritable swarms on the edges of high bushes, their legs outstretched, waiting for a ranging, unsuspecting, and wholly unprepared moose. When the moose lay in the snow, they leave carpets of blood from engorged ticks. When a baby moose emerges from the womb in Minnesota, a band of thirsty ticks moves from mother to neonate. The moose shed those fat, flush ticks onto fall and winter ground, and the ticks snuggle into the leaf litter rather than freeze in the snow, as they once might have, reducing tick mortality, but upping that of the moose. Bill Samuel is a careful scientist who does not jump to conclusions, and he sees many forces working together to kill off moose in the finely tuned orchestra that is the outdoors. Wolves, liver fluke, brain worms, unmanaged hunting, habitat loss, they are all part of the picture. Because of how it affects and is affected by those other factors, climate change, he told me, might be the major one. It's the ticks. Jill Auerbach knows that the winter ticks attached to dead and dying moose pose little threat as a species to humans whom they aren't prone to bite. But when news broke of moose losing half their blood to winter ticks, she was horrified and worried. Auerbach, an active woman in her 70s, was bitten in her 40s by a small tick that thrives in the woods, thickets, and backyard edges of the county in which she lives, in New York State's Hudson Valley. She lost 10 years of her life to that tick, had to retire as a highly rated programmer at the nearby IBM plant, and still suffers the aftermath of a case of Lyme disease that was caught too late. "It brought me to my knees," said Auerbach, among an all-too-significant share of people infected with Lyme who suffer long-term symptoms. To her, the rise of winter ticks is one more indicator of an environment out of whack, and so is the more measured but nonetheless relentless surge in black-legged ticks, like the one whose bite haunts her 30 years on. That other tick, known to scientists as part of the Ixodes genus, in Auerbach's case, Ixodes scapularis, or black-legged tick, is spreading across the United States and in many other countries with startling alacrity. Canada, the United Kingdom, Germany, Scandinavia, Inner Mongolia in China, and the Tula and Moscow regions in Russia. They are all grappling with large and growing numbers of disease-ridden ticks. Infected ticks have been found in urban parks in London, Chicago, and Washington, D.C., and in the open green expanses of Killarney National Park in Ireland's southwest. In Western Europe, where case reporting is not standardized, the official case count is 85,000 per year. A 2016 analysis, published in the Journal of Public Health at Oxford, England, put the number as 232,000. Signs of a burgeoning problem are apparent in Japan, Turkey, and South Korea, where Lyme cases grew from none in 2010 to 2,000 in 2016. When I asked three Spanish physicians in 2017 where Lyme disease was found in Spain, one said everywhere, and the others agreed. One of them, Abel Sadariaga Moran, had treated forestry workers in Andalusia, where he said symptoms are often managed perilously with traditional remedies. In the Netherlands, as elsewhere, warnings to protect Dutch hikers, children, and gardeners from bites had failed for years to curb the growing toll, then hit what may simply have been a saturation point, with Ixodes ricinus ticks inhabiting 54% of Holland's land. Across the Atlantic Ocean from Holland, the U.S. Centers for Disease Control and Prevention, CDC, in Atlanta, issues maps every year showing, by virtue of small black dots, the presence of Lyme disease cases in American counties. The CDC's 1996 map was the first to officially chart U.S. Lyme cases, although the disease was well along by then. Dots on that inaugural map collectively create an unremitting black smudge across the Atlantic shore from Delaware to Cape Cod, New Jersey, Connecticut, Massachusetts, and the lower reaches of New York State, where Auerbach contracted her case, are all inky black. A broken shadow runs along the Wisconsin-Minnesota border, too, with a handful of dots in many heartland states. But it is the change over the course of 18 years of maps that is telling, depicting the flowering of Lyme in a sort of cartoon flipbook style as it spreads across the Northeast and Midwest of America. North it goes, up New York's Hudson River Valley and into the state's Adirondack Mountains, jumping the border to Vermont's Green and New Hampshire's White Mountains. West and south it moves, great guns into Maryland and northern Virginia. By 2014, the dots consume much of Pennsylvania and darken New York's southern tier to the shores of the Great Lakes and the St. Lawrence River. The upper Midwest is liberally peppered. Dots appear in many other states, too. In 1996, black-legged ticks were known to be established, meaning there were enough counted to breed, or they already had, in 396 American counties. By 2015, researchers at the Centers for Disease Control reported the ticks were ensconced in 842 counties, an increase of 113%. Remarkably, the study's twin U.S. maps chart the forward march of ticks in much the way that the maps of Lyme cases plot the progression of disease. Both are relentless. Auerbach, who became a Lyme disease expert and advocate after her long-ago bout, has for years ended her emails with, "What's the problem? Well, it's the ticks, of course." They must be stopped, she believes, and the 2015 CDC map shows why. In it, ticks are seen moving into places that only a decade before had been considered ill-suited to support them, from the Allegheny Mountains to the Mississippi Valley, from western Pennsylvania south and east across Kentucky and Tennessee. In Minnesota and Wisconsin, I. scapularis appears to have expanded in all cardinal directions, the CDC researchers reported in language that was sometimes remarkable and alarming. The ticks have spread inland from the Atlantic seaboard and expanded in both northerly and southerly directions, they wrote, stopped only to the east by the Atlantic Ocean. Tick movement up the Hudson Valley is recent and rapid, the researchers wrote, their expansion overall dramatic. Where there had once been a divide between infestations in the Northeast and Midwest, they concluded, ticks merge to form a single contiguous focus, a shifting landscape of risk for human exposure to medically important ticks. On the move. Lyme disease emerged in coastal Connecticut in the 1970s, where symptoms akin to rheumatoid arthritis were reported in a circle of children unfortunate enough to be trailblazers of a disease in which early treatment is key to recovery. Diagnoses made late can portend long and difficult sieges of illness. Fatigue, joint pain, learning problems, confusion, and depression. The parents and guidance counselors of Lyme children and the children themselves as young adults have told me of school years lost to the disease. Children 5 to 9 years old have the highest per capita Lyme infection rate in the United States, while people 60 to 64 years old have the highest hospitalization rates for it, according to a study of 150 million U.S. insurance records from 2005 to 2010. The story of the emergence of Lyme disease now, of its rise in dozens of countries around the world, and of millions made sick, must be told through the lens of a modern society living in an altered environment. In the last quarter of the 20th century, a delicate array of natural forces indisputably were tipped, to transform Lyme disease from an organism that lingered quietly in the environment for millennia to what it is today, the substance of painful stories shared between mothers. A quandary for doctors who lack good diagnostic tests and clear direction, the object of rancor over studies that discount enduring infection while acknowledging persisting pain. The U.S. Centers for Disease Control and Prevention defines the word endemic, which it applies to Lyme disease, as the constant presence and/or unusual prevalence of a disease in a population within a geographic area. But while Lyme is firmly rooted in thousands of locales, it is surely not confined there, as climate changes, ticks move, and cases mount. The CDC's designation, even if scientifically accepted, is unfortunate. It serves to minimize the import of a disease that yields some 300,000 to 400,000 new cases in the United States each year, is found in at least 30 countries and likely many more, and is growing precipitously around the world. Lyme disease is moving, breaking out, spreading like an epidemic. The ticks that carry Lyme disease are, like spiders, arachnids, not insects. Although they cannot fly or jump, they are, for all practical purposes, climbing mountains, crossing rivers, and traversing hundreds, even thousands of miles to set up housekeeping. These feats are documented by scientists who are ingenious at finding ways to track and count ticks. They drag white flannel sheets across leafy forest carpets, sometimes infusing them with piped-in carbon dioxide, the mammal gas that makes ticks reach up, four legs outstretched to snag a passing meal. They catch avian migrants infested with hitchhiking arachnids. They count ticks on the ears of trapped mice and shrews, sometimes getting bitten in the process. They dissect bird nests, reach beneath leaf litter, and scour grassy sand dunes. When these researchers are lucky, they find data from some other era that proves their hunch that something has changed. In 1956, a scientist named Svetanovic in the Bosnian region of the then Socialist Federal Republic of Yugoslavia reported that Ixodes ricinus, the castor bean tick, could not survive at altitudes higher than 800 meters above sea level, or about 2,600 feet. But when Jasmin Omoracic of the University of Sarajevo took another look in 2004, collecting 7,085 castor bean ticks in the Dinaric Alps of Bosnia and Herzegovina, he found them living comfortably at 1,190 meters or 3,900 feet. In 1957, in Šumava, in then Czechoslovakia, researchers found the ticks could not survive at elevations above 700 meters. By 2001, biologists found them thriving at 1,100 meters. What those early observations pointed to, wrote Julian Medlock and his colleagues in 2013, is clear evidence of an altitudinal expansion of iriciness. Put another way, ticks are aggressively moving up, but they are also moving in other ways, and to places more suited than steep slopes to human habitation. In the Hudson Valley of New York State, a team from the University of Pennsylvania used Ixodes DNA to draw a family tree of black-legged ticks, much the same way that people use saliva swabs to search for distant ancestors in their genetic code. Studying ticks collected at four locations from 2004 to 2009, the researchers recreated a 125-mile upriver tick migration, similar to that of the colonial Huguenots and Livingstons three centuries earlier. The tree begins in southernmost Yorktown, where the tests showed the ticks residing, give or take, for the previous 57 years. Then, 17 years later, these eight-legged pioneers climb the next rung north to bucolic Pleasant Valley. 11 years pass, and they settle in Greenville, in the foothills of the Catskill Mountains. And 17 years later, emerge in northernmost Gelderland, where Dutch settlers from New Netherland had settled in 1639. While other DNA literally crept in along the way, mate-searching ticks do follow their hearts. By far, the most dominant strain at each point along the march was the one from southernmost Yorktown. The DNA, the researchers wrote, strongly support a progressive south-to-north expansion. Defying the odds, the ticks had moved to places where it had long been colder and snowier, and they did just fine. In Europe, ticks are on a similarly relentless march north. In Sweden, researchers studied the range of the castor bean tick from 1994 to 1996 by dragging cloths in 57 locations and querying residents about bites and sightings. They were able to establish a boundary line at about 60 degrees 5 minutes north, above which the ticks could not survive. By 2008, the ticks were found to have moved some 300 miles north, mainly along the Baltic coast, to about 66 degrees north. In Norway, the story was repeated. Twin surveys in 1943 to 1983 found the ticks unable to survive north of 66 degrees north. By 2011, they had traveled 250 miles to the highest known latitude in Europe, 69 degrees north, Oslo researchers reported, in a record that seems destined to be, if not already, broken. Nicholas Ogden is senior scientist in the National Microbiology Laboratory in the Public Health Agency of Canada. He has watched over the last two decades as black-legged ticks have leaped the U.S. border in a northerly trek, some 600 miles into Canadian territory. In 1990, the only documented location in Canada where the tick was found was in southern Ontario, in a town called Long Point, which is located on a thin strip of land jutting into Lake Erie and much closer to New York State than to Ottawa, Toronto, or Montreal. Less than two decades later, the ticks had established themselves in a dozen more Canadian locations, including in Manitoba, southeastern New Brunswick, and Nova Scotia. In 2008, Ogden and his colleagues mapped the risk of ticks moving north and predicted possible widespread expansion into south-central Canada. By 2015, another study put the forecast farther. Lyme-toting ticks would move about 150 to 300 miles north by 2050. That puts Canada in much the same position as the United States in the 1980s, and Ogden knows this. The world's second-largest country, which saw homegrown Lyme cases grow 12-fold from 2009 to 2013, is facing a burgeoning epidemic of Lyme disease. It is becoming a real public health problem, he told me. In 2015, Ogden and his colleagues employed a novel way to track the destination of ticks on migrating birds. Enter the gray-cheeked thrush, a plain, medium-sized bird and determined skulker that hides in the underbrush, making it prone to collect ticks. Ogden's team captured the thrush, along with 72 other tick-infested birds, as it crossed the Canadian border on its northward migration. Researchers then studied the molecular composition of its delicate metal-gray tail feathers. These rectrices, which help steer the bird in flight, bear a certain fingerprint, an isotope signature from the hydrogen in the water where the bird fledged. Knowing that birds usually return to the place of their birth, scientists concluded the thrush was destined for the farthest reaches of the study, which covered northern Ontario to the southern Canadian Arctic. Charles Francis, who monitors bird populations for the Canadian Wildlife Service, helped in the study. Very likely, there have always been ticks being introduced to northern areas because of migrating birds, he said. Only now, more of the ticks they carry are surviving in more places. By 2017, Canadian researchers reported that large swaths of Ontario had converted, as a paper in the journal Remote Sensing put it, from unsustainable to sustainable for Lyme-toting ticks. While the snowshoe hares struggle in the rugged Montana wilderness, ticks and their pathogens are thriving in a warming world, colonizing more places and multiplying there, just as they did in the last great post-ice age warming. 30 years ago, health officials in Canada told people with Lyme disease that they had almost certainly acquired the infection elsewhere, usually in travel to the United States. By the first decade of the 21st century, they had started to hedge their bets. A singular indicator. In 2014, the U.S. Environmental Protection Agency issued a 112-page report on the future of the United States in a warmer world. It began with a conclusion that had been denied, discounted, and politicized in the states for decades, but at last, or perhaps for the moment at least, was accepted as true. The Earth's climate is changing, temperatures are rising, snow and rainfall patterns are shifting, and more extreme climate events, like heavy rainstorms and record-high temperatures, are already taking place. Scientists are highly confident that many of these observed changes can be linked to the climbing levels of carbon dioxide and other greenhouse gases in our atmosphere, which are caused by human activities. The report consisted of 6 sections that attempted to describe and quantify the effects of global climate change on oceans, on the Earth's glaciers, on forests and lakes, and on people. In the report's 3rd edition in 2014, the agency included 4 new indicators to track and measure the impact of climate change. These included the number of annual heating and cooling degree days, which are showing Americans using more energy to cool rather than heat, incidents of wildfires, the water level and temperature of the Great Lakes, and last, Lyme disease. From this point forward, the agency would track the rate of reported Lyme disease cases across the United States as an official outgrowth and barometer of climate change. The tick-borne illness, with perhaps 4 million American cases since 1990, is the only disease to be accorded that dubious distinction. In discussing direct health impacts of a warmer Earth, the agency cites 2 other trends to watch. Heat-related deaths, which were estimated at 80,000 in the last 3 decades, and ragweed pollen seasons that cause painful allergies for millions. But Lyme disease has a singular distinction. It is an illness spread by ticks, the EPA report states, whose populations are influenced by many factors, including climate. In states from Maine to Florida and New York to California, across the breadth of southern Canada and in many parts of Europe, once sweeping woodlands have been reduced and divided, often into idealized forest fragments at the periphery of residential tracts, places where people can be close to, support, and observe wildlife. Multitudes live, work, and play in or near these green spaces, in a new epoch tentatively called the Anthropocene, the era marked by the hand of humanity. The irony is that these adulterated slices of nature and de facto nature preserves are incubators in many of these places of Lyme disease. The smaller the patch, in fact, the higher the proportion of diseased ticks, as documented in a study in Dutchess County, New York, where the per capita rate of Lyme disease is among the world's highest. In these fragments, small mammals like white-footed mice in North America and garden dormice in Europe have found havens, thriving in the absence of predators like foxes. In the language of tick-borne disease, the mouse is quaintly called a host for ticks and a reservoir of Lyme disease, the place where baby ticks, almost too small to be seen, get their first sip of infection. In city parks, suburban tracts, and exurban preserves, people come skin to skin with these ticks. In scores of studies, other environmental factors besides climate change, many controlled by human beings, are pointed to as drivers of this epidemic. The slicing and dicing of forests and the loss of biodiversity that followed is surely high on a complex and evolving list. While there is no single explanation for the 20th century emergence of Lyme disease, there is ample evidence that climate change has played no small part. Consider New Hampshire. At Pinkham Notch, a mountain pass along the Appalachian Trail, snowfall has declined an average of 4 inches every decade since 1970. And days below freezing have dropped by 3 per decade since 1960. Lilacs bloom earlier in New Hampshire, and the growing season is 2 to 3 weeks longer than in 1970. This ruggedly beautiful Northeast state had the United States' second highest rate of Lyme disease in 2013, with a 400% increase in cases since 2005. Other research suggests why. In the Krkonoshe Mountains in the northern Czech Republic, temperatures increased by 1.4 degrees Celsius in 4 decades, and irisinous ticks survive as high as 1,299 meters above sea level. They didn't decide to go climbing, a scientist there named Mikhail Kotsifikas told me. It's just that they can survive in these areas. In the Montérégie region of southern Quebec, extending south from Montreal to the St. Lawrence River, temperatures have risen since the 1970s by 0.8 degrees Celsius, and white-footed mice have thrived in shorter, warmer winters. Its range is rapidly shifting poleward, Canadian researchers wrote in 2013, pointing to an increasing body of empirical evidence to support the hypothesis that climate warming is a key driver of Lyme disease emergence, acting upon many levels of the transmission cycle of the disease. The questions are these: did a changing climate cause this epidemic? Or is climate change merely driving this sickness, with the ticks and animals that circulate it, to new places and new peoples? Evidence most certainly supports the latter. The former is trickier, but Lyme disease is distinctive as the first disease to emerge in North America, Europe, and China in the age of climate change, the first to become entrenched, widespread, and consequential to multitudes of people. It is growing, too, in places like Australia, where residents are told, as they were in southern Canada and still are in many parts of America, Canada, and Europe, that they must have some other illness besides Lyme disease, or if not, they contracted the infection somewhere else. "We're an island, we have island thinking," said a country GP from the mid-north coast of New South Wales named Trevor Cheney, who routinely diagnoses Lyme disease, though doctors are told it doesn't exist in Australia. As if migratory birds, which drop ticks far and wide, don't come there, he told me at a conference in Paris. Such poor advice has cost many Lyme patients valuable time to seek treatment. It stems from a failure by public health and medical experts to see the past as future. Lyme disease is moving to new places, as it has for nearly half a century. In the decades since the children of Lyme were infected, little progress has been made to control ticks, protect people from bites, test with certainty for the Lyme pathogen called Borrelia burgdorferi, and especially adequately treat the infected. Ixodes ticks, black-legged, castor bean, or otherwise, deserve our respect. They come armed not only with Lyme disease, but with a growing menu of microbes, bacterial, viral, and parasitic, known and yet unnamed. Ticks can, and sometimes do, deliver 2, 3, or 4 diseases in one bite. So resourceful are infected ticks that 2 feeding side by side on the same animal may pass pathogens one to the other and never infect the host. So clever is the Lyme pathogen that infected ticks are more efficient at finding prey than uninfected ticks. These ticks may not be able to fly or jump or trek more than a couple of human steps, but they have changed many lives, cost billions in medical care, and colored a walk in the woods or a child's romp in the grass, our very relationship with nature, with angst. This is all the more disturbing when we realize, ultimately, that it is we who unleashed them. Chapter 2. Invisible Assassin. She is a young, healthy woman in the photo, glossy blonde hair curling softly on her shoulders, red lips smiling, blue eyes shining. She looks confident and smart in a black blazer and white blouse, a glimpse of red reference books on a shelf behind her. Barbara Pronk is at her peak here, a time long ago, when she was happy and looking forward. Barbara had a good job as a personal assistant at Royal Dutch Shell in The Hague, an accomplishment in a country where professional work at a multinational company, no less, was not easy to come by. She had good friends, colleagues who knew they could count on her, and a mother who adored her. She was funny, ambitious, and beautiful, too. A slim, graceful young woman who dressed for work in much the way that she did her job, impeccably. Although she grew up and lived in a small Dutch city called Rijswijk, Barbara loved to travel in the worldly way of many of the Netherlands. There, in one of the Earth's most densely populated countries, where existence is defined by a struggle to hold back the sea, children learn English early and are schooled to see themselves as a small part of a big world. It was a world Barbara embraced. When she was in her 20s, Barbara spent 3 months living with friends near Clearwater, Florida, where she had planted a garden, a Dutch passion, and gone to the beach. During a sabbatical from Shell, she had lived in California for several months, honing her English in a college course in Santa Barbara and sealing her love for the States. An only child, she took regular cruises with her mother, Josephine van der Ven, who was also her good friend. They were so close that Barbara at one point had bought her own apartment but quickly sold it to move back with Josephine. In 2005, as her career and life were flourishing, Barbara began to get sick. She suffered overwhelming fatigue and all-over body pain. She developed skin problems and started losing hair. At the time, Barbara assumed it was the stress of a demanding job as secretary to the comptroller in Shell's oil and gas unit. When she fainted while shopping and needed first aid, she again wrote it off to overwork. She was too busy. She had too much to achieve to be ill. The illness had other plans, however. Over a period of 6 years, Barbara and her mother would travel widely and spend thousands of euros in her search for a diagnosis and a cure. Her symptoms, like those of many such patients, were what medicine calls nonspecific, not characteristic of a particular disease, but associated with a long list of them. She suffered unremitting joint and muscle pain. She was hypersensitive to light, touch, stress, and sound. Once acutely attuned to detail, she could not remember things, but was keen enough to know what it suggested: dementia. In her search for help, Barbara went to some 30 doctors and clinics in the Netherlands and other countries. Some doctors said she had myalgic encephalomyelitis or chronic fatigue syndrome, labels that more aptly described symptoms rather than disease. Other doctors were less kind, suggesting the problem might be, as Josephine put it, between her ears, or, as Barbara told a friend, attention-seeking. Barbara did not see it that way, and she started doing research of her own. It made her remember.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.